Dubit are an interactive agency. We develop digital products for the likes of Lego and National Geographic and Mattel and a whole host of brands. I have the research side of the business, so as part of us developing digital products, I think there's a lot of talks have been today is we're generally 20, 30 something year olds. We don't know how kids behave, so Dubit invests quite a bit of time in trying to understand how kids consume media, specifically how they use digital. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about one of our products, which is our trends product, which essentially tracks kids and parents aged 2 to 15 globally. I'm going to focus on Europe, since we're in Europe, and you can see we have data all across the world. We're about to go to deal with a couple of things that have happened that are really, really interesting over those 10 years, and perhaps most recently as well. So the big screen, the 10-foot screen, whether that be connected or a non-connected screen, is still the most accessed screen in the house across all of the countries. We're seeing, yes, there's a decline in linear TV and traditional TVs, but connected TVs are being switched on and they're being used now for their apps and for Xbox and everything else, and I'll touch on exactly what they're using for as well. The two trends that I think are interesting, so this looks at access across all of 2015s. The first is that tablets, access is still really, really high, but usage is in decline, and I'll explain why we think that is well once we kind of start to delve down into tablets. PC laptops, we're also seeing usage in decline there. That's as connected TV starts to become actually connected, and as smartphones age down more and more. So, in terms of all the devices, one of the things that we look at is we look at when they're used across a day, so we've got a whole host of data on what devices are used at different times of the day, what's the motivation for using that device at different times of the day, what are the content and brand trends across those different times of the day. What that allows us to do is it really allows us to understand when different types of content is going to work and what device is going to work on. So we call this emotional scheduling, and I explain what that means. As we get through, but the kind of premise is that media is fragmented, kids aren't scheduled by TV anymore, they're now using kind of their own emotional needs and the family's emotional needs to actually choose content at different times of the day. And that's really important. I know when Morris was talking about creativity, it kind of really helps think about when does a creative app work better. So for example, one of the things that we see is down this spectrum, so early on in the day around 2 to 4, 2 to 4 year olds, we see them really heavy use of tablets for kind of creative products. We don't see it with the older kids because they're on the school run, they're getting ready, it's all scheduled. So you see them using much more sit back kind of content and scheduled content. So you really see different content shifts as they go through the day. So let me start to focus a little bit on some of the different screens. Now, the TV, as we know, linear TV has had a massive decline over the last kind of 12 months. It's still huge. Kids still point of view on TV, so it's not a case of that going away. But it's definitely being displaced by this kind of OTT services. You can see the UK, the most likely to adopt kind of PVR and Xbox services. There's times following the US trends, it's a daily use. Kids in the UK really starting now to use Netflix, Amazon Prime. And I think Netflix is a really interesting thing because the way that we tend to find kids describe it is they beat it. So they actually binge watch it, consume it, get rid of it, wait for a new series to come out, and then re-get it. So they're actually learning the model of Netflix in quite a savvy way. We're also starting to see on the TV screen, we're starting to see, which we think is really interesting, apps being used. We're starting to see voice recognition become like a language that people understand. So we're starting to see some of those kind of connected features get used. I think that's really interesting for how you surface content via this big connected device. Just a quick look at S4 usage. I just think it's fascinating here. From a US and UK perspective, it's gone up. And that kind of coincides exactly with the decline in linear viewing for likes of Nickelodeon, Disney, and then Cartoon Network. So moving more on to the devices where gaming happens. So again, looking at kind of daily usage, gaming is the primary thing that kids use the tablet for. So you can see here, it outshines YouTube. Turkey YouTube usage really, really big. But generally, gaming is the main thing that kids are using the tablet for. And it really varies across different ages. brands that exist on other tablets, which we go through. Education apps and creative learning apps also play a big role. What do we want? Smartphone, now bear in mind, this is 2 to 15s, and these trends vary greatly as we look across the different ages. Using apps to play games, again, is the biggest thing. And when we actually start to look at the top brands across all platforms, you'll see how important that is, especially in the context of this conference. Now, one of the big trends that we've seen over the last 6 months, as I talked about, was the decline of the tablet in terms of usage. Now, this looks at the number of connected devices kids use across the ages here, across all these different markets. Now, what you're essentially looking at is that the bricks by way consume more devices and more media, as we'll see on the next slide, than some of the more traditional markets in across Europe. And actually, what we'll see is kids using between kind of 3 and 4 devices at a young age, but as they get older, between 5 and 6. Now, when we looked at these numbers a year ago, it was actually 8 or 9 devices. So one of the trends that we're seeing is some of these devices that are superfluous actually being put in drawers and not used anymore. So we are starting to see tablets, for example, if they're not used every day, get put in a drawer and get forgotten. So that's something we're starting to see. We're really kind of monitoring this kind of device amnesty closely to see what happens and what that means for content and device we should be creating that content for. When you look at connected screen usage across a week, so once you get to the age of 11 or 15, again, as Brits being the worst for connected screen, you're looking at a lot more screen and a lot connected time. In fact, I think we're working out kids are using screens more than they're sleeping. So that in the UK, 11 to 15, they're using over 3 days of connected screen time a week. And that is a big part of multi screen, but it is a really, really big trend. That's really hard for kids because actually, we spoke about emotional scheduling, it's really hard to figure out what content fits where. And it's also hard, and we spoke about that in the previous presentation, the conversation between parent and kid. When do you stop that? When do you allow it? And as we've already spoken about, gaming is a pretty dominant part of that. So depending on the age, the demographic, there's up to maybe a day's worth of gaming time per week by kids. That's potentially up to 3 hours a day, whether that be via casual games, console games, or wherever they're consuming those games. It's a really, really big play pattern. Now, there's no accident on this. This chart doesn't make sense a little bit, but when I spoke about emotional scheduling, you can see here where media is being consumed. So actually, this is you can't see on here, but it's a stack. So it looks at all the different kind of media formats and devices that are being used and stats up into across Europe, where kids are most consuming and most connected screen time. The really interesting thing with 7 to 10-year-olds is they're the ones that have the tablets. It's their main device because they might not necessarily have a smartphone yet. So tablet is their kind of connected device. Their younger brothers and sisters take in a TV screen. So what happens here is those 7 to 10-year-olds take the tablet and they go off to a quiet space and they use the tablet for whatever they might be using, whether they're Minecraft or quite often watching kind of YouTube videos for kind of reference and their kind of like niche interests, so quite often gaming is sitting within there. Once you get to the weekends, it's obviously much, much broader. So you see 9 a.m. until 12 p.m. lazy parents still in bed, and the kids have kind of started to really consume those connected screens. That's always been there. I think the really important thing to think about here is when kids are using those devices on their own, because parents are busy either doing the cleaning or staying in bed because they're hungover perhaps. Later on in the day, you can see from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m, tablet usage become like a really, really dominant kind of experience here. So, tons and tons and tons of media being consumed. What does that mean from a brand perspective? Well, the first thing that we've noticed that is really, really interesting, and it's continuing into this year as well, is when we ask kids, what's your favourite social media brand, entertainment app, gaming app, toy, TV show, we kind of ask them their favourites, their top of mind. The App Store isn't that intuitive for kids. They do tend to find new content. Even YouTube, which is a huge discovery platform for kids, it's quite hard for them to navigate sometimes. So actually, kids continue consuming these big five brands, whether they're TV shows or whatever they might be, they don't find new content as easily. Guardian involvement, so parent involvement, is critical across all of these, and we'll talk about what that means. And as we spoke, we looked at the whole media world. Access is hugely important because Candy Crush, Angry Birds can be switched on pretty much every all the time. And we're only just starting to see decline in things like Angry Birds. It's still kind of switched on by kids most weeks. So, we did a study with the University of Sheffield and CBeebies a couple of years ago called Tech and Play, which looked at tablets. And when we were doing work with academics, we said you're going to have to throw Candy Crush in there because it's a kid, the kids are playing, they're playing lots and lots, and it's a really interesting brand. They didn't want to put it in, they put it in, and we got some really, really interesting things out of it. Mobile smartphones have quite often been kind of solo uses as an individual, or all being a social sharing element as well from that social media perspective. What Candy Crush did is it brought generations together. So we went and spoke to tons and tons of boys and girls, and this specific grandma here, I only saw her granddaughter every couple of weeks, and she got stuck on Candy Crush levels after day three and had to wait a week and a half for her granddaughter to come out and unfix it so she could continue playing Candy Crush. That's a hugely rich emotional experience, and traditionally kind of these devices didn't provide the same thing as a Roald Dahl or a John Kipling book did, or some of these kind of evergreen TV content. So all of a sudden digital is actually creating this bond between two generations. That's hugely powerful in kind of long-term play and long-term consumption. I have no issue turning the TV off. Gone, you're away from the TV screen. So straight away, Minecraft is almost creating guilt complex in parents. The second thing it did is it connected generations. So these were three boys who lived in Compton in LA, lived with their mum in a single bedroom house. They all shared a bunk bed. But Minecraft was like this world of creativity and imagination for them. And the really cool thing about it was the little brother was teaching, the big brother taught, the middle brother who taught the little brother then learned new skills, fed that back up to the big brother, dragged the big brother back into it, he'd lapsed from it. Mum got involved because she said, why not build this place because we're going here on holiday or the next door neighbour's house. All of a sudden you had this kind of all these generations kind of involved in one product. And the really cool thing was we kind of spoke about that kind of like 8 p.m. time. This boy, this 8-year-old boy, he had two younger siblings. And when they were going through a whole bedtime routine, parents were knackered because they kind of shepherded three kids through the day and kept all three of them alive. And this boy then was taking the tablet, was going to his parents' bedroom because it was the quietest place in the house, and was then sitting back and watching 45-minute episodes on YouTube. It was the only time he could have really watched long-form content. So that's what he was using, is YouTube. It was really interesting because he needed that downtime. So the second thing is the idea of emotional scheduling. Learning here from Plug-in Media kind of spoke about making sure you create the right content for the right time, for the right platform. And I think emotional scheduling and multi-platforms sit alongside that. So what we think about now is rather than trying to own an hour of a kid's time every other week, try to own 5 minutes every day. As you can see, he's meant that Candy Crush and Angry Birds is at the same level as Lego, because they've owned 5 or 10 minutes of every single day. And that's hugely, hugely powerful. They know exactly where they sit. Kids know when to use it. It's an easy conversation with a parent. The final thing is this multi-platform. It's kind of obvious. One of the trends that we've seen happen is when digital was first starting, the App Store was first starting, when the kids were searchers, they watched Peppa Pig, therefore they went to the App Store and searched Peppa Pig. What's happened is that proper game developers have created really good apps, and now kids don't need the Peppa Pig title to navigate the App Store, they know where the good games are. But I think the really important thing is to make sure that you're creating the best content for the flight device rather than just replicating across content. And Michael from Hasbro spoke about earlier, you know, kind of not just creating a shooting game for the Nerf guns. I think it's making sure you take the essence of that, adapting it in a unique and authentic way. I think that's it.
So you mentioned tablets a few times. So do you know what those tablets are? Is it mostly iPad? Is it a little bit of Android? Is it some other tablets?
I can share all that. We have that data broken down by marketplace and by the device manufacturer. It's primarily Apple, but when you go into the Asian markets, you see Samsung kind of show up as well. So it does vary across markets, but Apple is definitely still the dominant player that we see.
Cool, thanks.
When we say that we should develop games for special time, for special needs, doesn't it mean that when creating the game, it might lose the main idea? And for example, we have some almost art projects for kids and so on. You cannot always think about the data, about the time best for kids to play. Still, how should the developer combine these things?
Kids' media lives are really, really busy. So if you're going to create a new piece of content, A, it's hard to discover, and B, it's hard to push on the brand. You're going to have to display some of the brand. So what we're looking at is where there's opportunities in a kid's life to insert a new piece of content. So we're working with some like National Geographic, and we're thinking, when does a National Geo style of content actually fit into a kid's life? Okay, we've seen a gap there. That's a need. They have that time. They're open to learning creativity. What device are they using? What they're currently using on that device? So we're kind of building up from that perspective. Now, being a researcher, as you can see from these charts, entirely uncreative, what I'm kind of then hoping to say to kind of my creative colleagues is, there's a spot here where we know there's an opportunity to create a piece of content, and then the creators do their job.
Thank you.